Well, good morning. Welcome to Dunwoody United Methodist Church. We sure are honored to be in worship with you this morning, especially if you're visiting with us for the first time. We'd love to connect with you. We'd love to get to know you. We'd love to hear some of your story, and we'd love to share some of our story too. So if you could, either scan the QR code that's on the screen, or you can fill out the red pew attendance pad. We'd love to reach out to you. Friends, just one announcement before we begin worship. We are currently building our 31st Habitat home, and we are in need of some additional volunteers. So if you've been around this church for very long, you know this is part of a rich tradition of serving our community, and what a great opportunity for you to not only serve, but to get to know some other folks from the church. So you can go to our church website, dunwoodyumc.org/go, and register for an opportunity to help serve on that Habitat house. Friends, as we begin worship this morning, would you stand and share in this call to worship? May God be gracious to us and bless us. Let all people praise you, O Lord. God blesses us continually throughout all our lives. Amen. Would you remain standing as we sing our processional hymn, hymn number 715, Rejoice, the Lord is King. Would you remain standing as we share together our affirmation of faith, which is the Apostles' Creed this morning. Join with me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated, and I'd like to invite John and Annie Minor to come and to present their children for baptism this morning. Good morning. Dearly beloved, baptism is an outward and visible sign of the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, through which grace we become partakers of his righteousness and heirs of life eternal. Those receiving the sacrament are marked as Christian disciples and initiated into the fellowship of Christ's holy church. Jesus gave little children a place among the people of God, which holy privilege must not be denied them. Remember the words of Jesus, how he said, "Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God."
Annie and John, I have these questions I ask you now on behalf of the whole church. Do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, say, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, putting your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to all people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, say, I do. And will you nurture each of your children in God's holy church, that by your teaching and example that they may be guided into God's presence and grace for themselves, profess to their faith openly, and lead Christian lives? If so, say, I will.
I will.
And now I say to you, as the congregation gathered in this place, do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? If so, say, we will.
We will.
Will you nurture also one another in the Christian faith and life, and include these children who come now before you in your care? If so, you respond to the words upon the screen. With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these children with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their service to others. We will pray for them, that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. O gracious and loving God, we thank you for these waters that are before us. When nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. And after the flood, you set a cloud of rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan River to the land which you promised. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of the womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in his baptism and death and resurrection, to make disciples of all nations. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water to those who receive it this day. Amen.
What name is given this child who is eager to get baptized?
Jackson Richard Meyer.
Come here, bud. Here we go. Look at all these people that love you. You ready? Jackson Richard Minor, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Do you want to touch the water?
Yeah.
May you always remember your baptism and this day. Let's see if you'll go to Mr. David.
Yeah, I'll hold you just there a second.
Go, here we go. Hello there.
And what name is given this child?
Catherine Claire. For care Claire Catherine Claire.
Can we take this out? Dare we?
Do it.
Claire Catherine Minor, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Claire, Jackson, this is now your gathered extended family. They are going to help nurture you in a life of faith. They're going to take responsibility to help nurture you in the UMW, wherever you maybe you're set for the UMW. Maybe they will teach your Sunday school class. They will help guide you in a life of faith. They'll take you to lunch after church. You just don't know what these people will do to help you fall more deeply in love with Jesus. And we're thankful for all of them, and we're thankful for your parents who gather with you and will love and nurture you the rest of your days. May we pray together. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for the love that John and Annie have for each other and have for you, for the family that is gathered in this place, and for these beautiful children who come before you this day, open to your great love for them. Help them to grow in wisdom and in grace each and every day of their life until that day when they for themselves are able to make a decision for you and are confirmed and strengthened in the way that leads to life eternal. Hear our prayers for this family. May they know the peace of your presence as we seek to be in ministry to this community in ways we haven't even yet imagined. In your name we pray and give thanks. Amen.
As we enter into this time of prayer, I want to draw your attention to the prayer concerns, which you will find on the back side of your bulletin. I encourage you to pray for each of these names throughout the week as you go about your daily prayer lives. In particular, we want to lift up Stephen and Amber Rowe and celebrate with them on the birth of their daughter, Frances Elaine Rowe, on May 12th. With this celebration and all of the other cares and concerns of our hearts on our minds, let us go before God in a moment of silent prayer, followed by pastoral prayer and the Lord's Prayer. I suppose.
We would also like to invite to the altar this day those people who are renewing their vows of membership. Chuck and Carol Geray have been members of this church for 24 years. Bill and Jana Benston for 20 years. And their son Will, 11 years, and then George and Marianne Cowgill of 22 years. And we especially lift up the family of John and Martha Head. I was out in Snellville, as Kathy was this week. John has been put into hospice care out in Snellville, and he is at Eastside Hospital, Piedmont Eastside out there. They wanted to renew their vows from home online because they've been watching faithfully online. But he is in the final stages of life, and we just ask that we lift them up as we go to God in prayer together. Thank you.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for another morning, another beautiful day, another opportunity to experience your love and your grace and to share it with others. As we come to worship today, O God, we know that each of us carry with us different experiences, different emotions, different cares, different burdens, and different joys. We bring to you all that we are this week, knowing that you hold all that we bring with us and make it beautiful. Oh God, today we pray for those in our midst who are hurting, those who suffer in body or in spirit, those who hunger for your presence, who hunger for something more. We pray, O God, that your presence might be felt in all of those places that need your care. We pray that you will bind up the brokenness in our midst. Everywhere where there is pain, where there is oppression, where there is violence, where there is want, we ask, O God, that your provision will be known. In particular, God, we pray for those who are victims of violence throughout the world, not only those who are fleeing war in places like Ukraine, but those who are close to home and experiencing loss because of anger and because of violence. In particular, we lift up the family of Marita Harrell, a beloved clergy colleague who lost her life this week. God, there is so much that we want to say to you, but there is also so much that we struggle to find the words to say. And so, God, we ask that you would search our hearts and know them fully, love us for all that we are, and take all that we are and turn it into something beautiful that we might be for the world, the hands and feet that offer care, that offer kindness, that seek to bind up wounds and to bring comfort from pain. We pray all of these things, loving God, in the name of your Son, Jesus, our brother and our Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Amen.
Amen indeed. As we worship today, we rejoice that our praise and prayers are not the limits of our adoration of God. We also adore God in our lives and in our actions. And if you desire to respond to God's grace by giving this morning, we have lots of ways that you can do that. You'll see instructions here on the screen, and you'll find information in your pews as well. But know that no matter how you give or what you give, your gifts are helping us here at Dunwoody United Methodist Church to make a difference in our communities and throughout the world. One particular way that I want to lift up this week is our middle school mission trip, which is leaving here in the first couple of days of June, but we know that everyone's going to be gone for next week, or not everyone. We hope you're here. But because we know that Memorial Day follows between now and then, we want to lift those students up today, make sure they get our full blessing. If we have any middle schoolers who are going on that mission trip, would you stand where you are? Or any leaders who are accompanying? Yes. All right. We won't make you stay standing, but we give thanks for you. And as we continue in our worship, I hope that you will just take a moment with me and offer a quick blessing. If you want to reach out a hand, we'll see if we can cover these students and their leaders with our love. Gracious God, go with each of these students and the adults who lead them as they seek to make a difference in your world. Go with them to Sevierville, Tennessee, as they serve these next couple of weeks. Help them to know the peace and the joy and the gratitude that comes from being your hands and feet in the world. We pray all of these things in the name of your Son and in the unity of your Holy Spirit. Amen. With that on our minds, let us continue our worship together.
Amen. You may be seated. Anne Lamott, one of my favorite authors, says there are three essential prayers in her book by the same name. You ready? The three essential prayers are help, thanks, and wow. Got it? Help, thanks, and wow. Those are the three essential prayers. It's a prayer I pray every Sunday morning. Lord, help intercede between what I say and what people hear, so that they might hear your good news as proclaimed, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts might be acceptable in thy sight. Help me, Lord. And after that prayer of help, I think we can all say wonderful prayers of thanksgiving. There's so many things to be thankful for. I was visiting with Chris Mixer yesterday. Some of you volunteered for Habitat. Any of you, would you stand or raise your hand? Some of our Habitat volunteers yesterday, they were out there bright and early, and I helped John Ritchie, didn't I? I pounded one nail and I brought donuts. Elizabeth would tell you, she knows what I'm capable of, and that is about the best that you could get from me. I can bring donuts with the best of them, but I'm thankful for all those. And Chris said this, he said, there's so many good things going on in the life of the church that it's hard to celebrate and feature them all at the same time. And it is true, there are so many wonderful things to give thanks for and to celebrate this week. We played in the Reinhardt Golf Tournament where we were able to help students have scholarships at Reinhardt. And about halfway through the course, at a grueling course up on Lake Arrowhead, we came across this box that I want to give thanks for. A couple of kids had put this box there and it said, if you've lost a ball, it should have said, since you've lost a bunch. But it said, if you lost a ball, here's a gift from us. Isn't that wonderful? You just want to say, wow, thank you, thank you, thank you. There's much to give thanks for this week as we finish our sermon series, The Beautiful Oops. I'm thankful that God can take my mistakes and redeem them in beautiful ways. I'm thankful that God can even redeem my hapless Pittsburgh Pirates. They were no hit by the Reds this week and still won the game. That is a beautiful oops. You have to give thanks for those kind of things. Help, thanks, and wow. In our scripture text today, Jesus deals with a beautiful oops. A few weeks ago, we were supposed to lift up all of our recipients for our high school students to get college scholarships, and one of them, like you, John, is going to Georgia Tech, Presley Boughton. Presley, are you back there? No, she's not back there today. She was here 2 weeks, and I didn't mention it, and so the week that I miss her, she's not here, but we do have a card that our youth ministry put together to say thank you, and it's a beautiful way to redeem my oops. We love you, Presley, and it has a great scripture verse. They made these cards for each of our youth who are graduating. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not people. It's one of the things I'm thankful for today, our amazing youth ministry, and we send our blessings to her as she heads to Georgia Tech. There's so much to be grateful for, and we're grateful for the scripture today where there is an oops. 10 people are healed, and only one comes back and says thank you. But Jesus is able to take that story, and Luke relates it in such a way that there is redemption to even that oops. And Gail Owens, one of our newest staff people, and Calissa Dotterman have collaborated to help hear the scripture from the Gospel of Luke. Take a look and a listen.
On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? Then he said to him, get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well.
Aren't we blessed by some amazing artists in the life of our church? I talked to Gail about it and she said, did you see my oops? Did anybody catch it? Yes. There were 11, but there were 10 lepers and Jesus, we told her. I thought that was the best suggestion. It could have been 10 lepers and Gail or 10 lepers and Jesus. Either way, I thought it worked out just beautifully. So it is wonderful the way that God takes our 11 oopses and makes something beautiful out of it. I've been having some pain in my back recently. Anybody else dealing with aches and pains? You ever have more than a few aches and pains? Pain is a wonderful teacher. Pain can make you more aware. Pain can get you to pay attention in the way that some other things can't. These 10 lepers all were in pain, and it was not just a physical pain. They, in fact, had physical pain, but they also had emotional pain because they were ostracized and forced to live on the outside of the city and essentially wear a sign on themselves that said, unclean. See? Unclean. Can you imagine having to shout out everywhere you went about the uncleanliness in your life? For we all have places in our life that we are not proud of. We all have places in our lives that we are unclean. And imagine having to shout out your favorite of the 7 deadly sins. The way I remember them is Gilligan's Island. Skipper is gluttony. Ginger is lust. Mary Ann is jealousy. The professor is pride. Mrs. Howe is sloth. Mr. Howe is greed. And they're all always angry at Gilligan, who wears red and is the Satan character who keeps them trapped in the hell of their own sin. But that's a story for another day. But just imagine if you had to yell out what your uncleanliness was. Let's try it. Maybe not. We are good. Some people are good at sharing their physical pain. They're willing to share the physical pain that they're going through, but it's much more unlikely for them to share the emotional pain that they're going through. They are not willing to necessarily share that, and they keep that in their silent silo, and they try to go it alone. At least these lepers who were a mix of Samaritans and Jews did not have to go it alone. They were there at the border between Samaria and Galilee. And Jesus comes to this village along that border, and they are outside of the village, united in their pain. You know, I have to say that when people are together in their pain, some other differences start to fade away. I can tell you that in the infusion lab, no one is asking you about your politics. No one is asking about you about which team you root for or which side you're on a particular issue. When you're in the infusion lab, you're all praying that same prayer. Help. 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 And you put yourself at God's mercy. And these poor lepers who have been ostracized, they had to leave home and family, and they're out there at the edge of the city. And they at least have each other, and I'm guessing they rehearse it because they want to make sure Jesus hears them. They're supposed to be yelling, unclean, unclean, and instead they yell, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Let's see if we can get it together without too much rehearsal. And they cry out to Jesus, which is a really helpful thing to do when you're feeling unclean, when there is some sort of malady in your life, when there's some place in your life that needs healing. They cry out to Jesus, and they cry out and they use the word master. And that word master, epistata, how do I say it right? You got it? I thought you were the Greek scholar for us, right? epistata or epistata, I've heard both pronunciations. This Greek word for master is only used 7 times in the Gospels, and it's all in the Gospel of Luke. And the first 6 times that this word is used, it is used by a disciple. A disciple says the word. They haven't caught anything all night, and they say to Jesus, "Master, we haven't caught anything," and Jesus provides an abundance of fish. They are perishing on a boat in the midst of a storm, and this time they say it twice. They're emphatic, "Master, Master," and they cry out to Jesus saying, "Can't you see that we are perishing?" And Jesus comes to give the gift of calming a storm. The third time it happens is that beautiful passage where the woman who's had a hemorrhage for 12 years just knows that if she can only touch the hem of his garment. Do you remember that? If I can just touch Jesus, I know that I will find some healing in my life. And they say, "Master, the crowd is pressing in." And then they're on the mountain of transfiguration, and Peter says, "It's good for us to be here. Let's stay here, Master. Let's build 3 dwelling places and just hold on to this wow moment." And then there's one more time where people are casting out demons, and the disciples bring it to Jesus, and they begin to complain, and they say, "How dare they be doing that and not be doing that through you?" And Jesus says, "Oh, come on, you need to concentrate on more important things, because whoever is not against us is for us." And here these would-be disciples, these people at the margins, these people at the edge of society because of a skin disease, they're out there yelling for Jesus for help. "Jesus, Master, have mercy upon us." Has that ever been your prayer? Or maybe the prayer was just as simple as "help." Anne Lamott says it's amazing that people don't even believe that there is a God will pray that prayer of help when they are desperate. And these people must be desperate, and they cry out to Jesus for help. "Have mercy upon us." And Jesus looks at them. It says he sees them. He really sees them in their pain. And that is a wonderful thing, to be seen in our hurt and to be seen in our pain. And he sees them, and then he says, "Go and show yourself to the priest. Go and show yourself to the priest." Because according to Leviticus 13, the priests were the arbitrators of health. And you could read back all the different laws. And in order to show that you were clean, you had to go and stand before the priest and get the blessing of the peace before you could return to society. And Jesus tells them to obey the law and to go and show themselves to the priest. It reminds me of that wonderful story from 2 Kings, the 5th chapter. Do you remember the story of Naaman the Syrian? He was a mighty warrior, and yet he had leprosy. I bet that put fear into his enemies to see him and with his leprous skin. And he heard that there was someone who could bring healing to him back in Israel. And so he went to Israel, and he went to the king, and the king basically said, "I don't know anything about this," but somebody whispered to him and said, "There is a prophet in Israel named Elijah who can bring healing to your life." And so he went to the prophet Elijah, and the prophet Elijah, just like Jesus said, "Go. Go and show yourself to the priest." Elisha says, "Go and wash in the River Jordan 7 times. That seems pretty simple, right? Go and wash in the Jordan 7 times. But Naaman got angry. This is exactly what happened. Naaman became angry and went away saying, "I thought that for me," because it's about him, "I thought that for me, he would surely come out and just stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and would wave his hand over the spot and cure the skin disease." Isn't that the way that we want God to work? We just want God to come out and snap God's fingers or wave God's hand and have everything be okay. We've got something going on, some need or some hurt. And then he goes on, he says, "Are not the rivers of Damascus better than the rivers here in Israel?" Come on, I could have just gone to take a bath there. I didn't need to come all the way to Israel. And he said, "Could I not wash in them and be clean?" He turned away and went away enraged. But his servants approached and said to him, "Father, if the prophet had commanded you to do something difficult, would you not have done it?" Why are we willing to do the difficult things and sometimes not to do the seemingly easy things? when we are in crisis, when we are hurting, when we are in pain, that pain should be a signal for you. How much more when all he said to you was wash and be clean? Such a simple thing. Go and get some help. When I think God must get frustrated with us sometimes because we come to God and we say we want healing in this particular area in our life. God, I need some healing with my finances, and we want God to do this. And God says, no, you need to go and take a financial peace class at the church. We have that possibility for you. Or you're in the midst and struggle with a relationship, and you just want God to fix that relationship. And God says, no, you need to go and talk to Kathy Brockman about getting a Stephen minister to help you process through that. Or you need to go to an amazing counselor. My friend Ron Greer is here. Where's Ron? I saw him there. Ron is one of the gifts of the North Georgia Conference, one of the gifts of my life. He's one of the wisest and kindest counselors that I know in the world, and he's written some tremendous books that have been helpful to me and to other people. And Ron is a person that if you are looking for help and healing, go see someone like Ron. He can help. He can help. But too often we're like, oh, I don't want to do that. I don't want to go and do something. I just want to be healed. And Jesus says, go and show yourselves to the priest. Go and take that first step. You're struggling with addiction. You're struggling with whatever it might be. You need to go and take that first step. When I first started out in ministry, I had to deal with my first crisis. And my first crisis, I was 22 years old, and I'd had a year of seminary, but I didn't know anything. And this young couple came to my house. I didn't even have an office. They had to come to the house. And they came to the house, and they told me that they just had a miscarriage. And I didn't know what to say. I didn't know how to respond. I finally said that I would pray with them. I prayed for them, and then I called my mom. My mom's a nurse, and I was like, Mom, what do I say? I mean, I need to talk through this with somebody. And she said, Phil, you do know that your brother is 10 years older than you. And I was like, yeah, I've got one older brother. She said, do you think that during the time from your brother's birth to your birth that there weren't miscarriages involved in our family? And I said, no, Mom, I never knew that. And she didn't share with me a clinical response. She shared with me her pain. And I realized that the people that I was counseling needed to find a way to share their pain. Because if they just shared their pain, I knew that there was somebody else in the church who had been along that road before them. I know that if you're in pain today, if there's some hurt or struggle in your life, there are people in this church who are walking that same road or who've walked that road before you, who would be glad to walk that road alongside you today if you just moved from help to go. If you were just willing to go and ask for some help. So I said to that young couple, I said, would you consider allowing me to share that as a prayer concern with the congregation? And they said, yes, we need that kind of support. And I shared it with the congregation, and a silent army of women showed up to surround them who had been through it but had never publicly told their story. It is a wonderful thing to be able to ask for help and to know that you are not alone. For life gives each of us more than we could ever handle alone. And we share that prayer, help, help. And sometimes it is our prayer, and sometimes it is a prayer that is lifted for you. There are times when you don't know how to pray as you ought, and the scripture tells us that the Holy Spirit intercedes with us with sighs too deep for words. And when we don't know what to pray for, there are people who are praying for you. I love the Tony Campolo story. Well, before that, where's my friend Mike Cordell? Mike's here. Is he There he is. Mike was one of my mentors, and I probably should have called him when I didn't know what to do when that young couple came in. Mike was my teaching parish professor, and he taught me how to write thank you notes. And I know that I can write a thank you note, and even if you can't read it, it will be okay. And I learned that because Mike's handwriting is worse than mine, if you can believe that. And Mike was a gift to me to help me through those difficult situations in the beginning of ministry. And I wouldn't be a Methodist pastor in the North Georgia Conference today without him. He was the one that made me a member of his church in Bremen so that I could stay here in North Georgia and not go back to Pennsylvania. Mike, thank you. It's wonderful to have clergy colleagues that are a gift to your life and pour into you and help mold you into who you become as a minister. I thank both of these gentlemen and so many others who have given of themselves, that they've prayed for me over the years to get through some of the difficulties of early ministry and beyond. And it's a great gift to have others praying for you. One of my favorite stories about having other people praying for you is Tony Campolo tells the story that he was going to speak at a Pentecostal college in Pennsylvania. And when he got there, they said, well, we need you to kneel in prayer before you speak. And as he knelt in prayer, 10 men surrounded him and put their hands on his head. And he said, the longer they prayed, the harder they pressed. He said, I could feel the weight of their hands. He said, I was doing my best not to have my head just topple off my neck. They were pressing so hard, and they prayed so fervently, and they prayed, and they prayed, and they prayed, and they prayed. They prayed for what I was going to say. They prayed for the students who were going to hear me. They started praying for people in the community, and the longer they talked, the harder they prayed. He said, one guy just went off on a tangent about somebody he'd met that morning. He said, Lord, I want you to intercede in the life of Charlie Stoltzfus. Charlie has been having a rough time, and he decided today that he's going to leave his wife and their three kids. And you know Charlie, he lives in that trailer down at the end of the street, and it's the third one on the right. You know exactly where it is. And Campolo's thinking, yes, God knows. You don't have to tell God where Charlie lives. But he said, you know, they just kept praying fervently for this and for that. And finally, he said, he got up and kind of stretched and was able to speak and knew that he had been well prayed for. After he finished, he got in his car to drive back to Philadelphia, and he got on the Pennsylvania Turnpike. And just as he was there at the on-ramp on the Pennsylvania Turnpike, he tells the story that he saw a hitchhiker. And he stopped and he picked the hitchhiker up, and they got in the car and they're driving along. And he says, I'm Tony Campolo. And the guy says, I'm Charlie Stoltzfus. Campolo can't believe it, but he doesn't say anything. He just goes to the next exit, gets off, turns around, and heads back the other way. And Charlie says, Mister, where are we going? And Campolo says, I'm taking you home. And Charlie kind of backs up to the edge of the car and is sort of bug-eyed watching him drive him. He drives him to the school. They drive down the road. They stop at the silver trailer at the end of the street. And he says, what are you doing? He says, I'm taking you home. I'm taking you home. He said, how did you know where I lived? And Campolo said, God told me. And he really believed it. He really believed that God had told him, because when Charlie sheepishly got out of the car and made his way to the door of that silver trailer, his wife burst out and with tears in her eyes said, you're home. You're home. You're home. And all I think Campolo could say was, wow. Wow. Help, thanks, and wow. They're such simple prayers. I'm thankful for the work of Paul Brand that I recently discovered. Paul Brand has written a book called The Gift of Pain, and he grew up the child of missionaries in India, and he saw so many people suffering with leprosy that he went and got medically trained in England with the idea that he would come back and help lepers in India to find health. He really struggled because they were able to cure the bacteria that caused leprosy, but people were still having health deteriorate after they had cured the bacteria, after they had cleansed these people of the bacteria in their system. And it was driving him crazy because he said, these people are continuing to go blind, they're continuing to have deformities, they're continuing to lose limbs, and he just couldn't understand it. And then this is what he figured out. He figured out that lepers, people who have experienced leprosy, can no longer feel pain. And because they can no longer feel pain, he said they didn't need to blink, because when we blink, it lubricates our eyes and gets rid of impurities, and they would never blink and it would cause blindness. Or they would have a sprained ankle and they wouldn't feel it, so they would keep walking on it, and pretty soon they had destroyed their whole foot. And that foot would need to be amputated because they had destroyed their whole foot because they didn't feel any pain. And what Brand said is that pain can be a gift. And that there are good pains, and pain should be a signal that something is wrong and we need to do something about it. But too often, we want to deny our pain. We want to avoid any sort of pain. We want to minimize our pain. And we don't know what to do when other people are in pain. I got a phone call recently. Someone in our church had had a loss, and I got the phone call, and they said, what do we do? And I said, you go to their house. And they said, what do we say? I said, nothing. That's why the casserole was invented. You just go and you take some food and you hand them the food and say, I'm sorry, I love you, and you hug them. And then don't say anything else, because anything else you say will probably be wrong. But you go. When people are hurting, you go. Elizabeth and I have a rule in our house that you'll never regret going when someone is hurting. And so we go and we sit and we sometimes bring a casserole to let people know that they are loved. I don't know what exactly to do this week. You heard in the prayer this morning that one of our 57-year-old pastors, she and I are the same age, Marita Harrell, was brutally stabbed and killed and then put in a van that was set on fire by a young man that she had been trying to help. She felt called to ministry after moving down here from Chicago, Illinois, to go to Emory. She worked at the AJC for many years, and as a second career person, felt called to ministry. She felt called to help people who were on the margins, people who felt like they were unclean, people who needed an extra bit of care and concern. And she was working with this young man because of his cries for help. And the thank you that she got was to be stabbed and killed. And we mourn the loss of one of our colleagues this week who gave and gave of herself and then had her life so brutally taken. And I think if I talked to Marita today and I was able to say, Marita, would you do it again? She'd say, of course. Of course, you have to go where people are hurting. Jesus was willing to cross boundaries and to go where people are hurting. And she said, I would go to the people who are hurting. And I would say, Marita, but he took your life. And she would look at me and say, no, Phil, I gave my life. I gave my life. And that's what it means to follow the one who gave his life for us. Such simple prayers. Help, thanks, and wow. That one leper who came back to Jesus was supposed to go and show himself to the priest. And it always bothered me because I felt like when he went to show himself to the priest, they were healed in their obedience. So disobedience brings destruction. Obedience brings healing. And Jesus tells them to go and show themselves to the priest. So the text says, while they were on their way, they were healed. And isn't that really how it happens? Healing is not a destination. It's a process. It's a road to recovery. And on the way, they were healed. And then he turns around and goes back to thank Jesus. And that bothered me because I thought he was supposed to go and show himself to the priest. Right? And he was obedient, and then he gets healed, and now he's disobedient, and he turns back to go see Jesus. Until this week, when I realized, and I don't know why it is, but it takes sometimes, some of us are hard-headed, and sometimes it takes longer for God to communicate to us what God's trying to tell us. What I realized this week is that he does go to the priest, Jesus, the great high priest, who, as Hebrews said, is the great high priest who understood our suffering yet was not led into temptation. And so he falls down at the feet of the great high priest. And then Jesus says to him, "Go, go. Your faith has made you well." And I put together the sign that is the word in the Greek for what made well means. It says, "Your faith has made you whole." And I walked in where Matt was working with our Spark kids today, and the kids looked at me and said, "Why are you holy?" And I thought, out of the mouths of babes, because we trust in a God who can take our uncleanliness, and through forgiveness and grace and a willingness to go and wash in the Jordan 3 times. If you're dealing with some uncleanliness in your life this week, I invite you to go home today in the privacy of your kitchen or your bathroom and wash 7 times and ask God where you think God needs you to go in order to find the healing that you need. May we be willing to give our lives for the call of the gospel. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we all have our places that we fall short. We all have our unclean places, and we call out to you for help, and you send us to go. Help us to go where we are needed. Help us to go where there is hurting. Help us to be willing to give our lives for something worthwhile. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn is "The Church's One Foundation." And as we stand together and sing, I invite those who want to join in the membership and the fellowship of this church to come forward. Will you come? Friends, I need to trust God more. I wanted to cut one of those verses. I knew it was getting long. But that extra verse gave Natalie the time to decide that she was called to reunite with the United Methodist Church. Natalie is a seminary graduate. She's a counselor and a good friend. And she grew up in this church. She learned, she was baptized here and confirmed here and has preached in this church. And you have loved her back. So thank you. So Natalie Stadnick and Marcia Swanson are our two newest members. And Marcia is a Wisconsin girl. Any Wisconsin folks there? Raise your hands. Okay, we got a few there. I know that you want to come and check out her accent. She has been a nurse in a wide variety of settings, bringing healing to people's bodies and their souls. And she loves to garden. She lives over at Huntcliffe. And it is just a great gift to have you here. Natalie, welcome back. I ask you, will you live out your faith through this congregation of the United Methodist Church and uphold it with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness?
I will.
We welcome you as the newest members, the newest remember. You've been remembered today. Welcome back, Dr. Marshall. We're blessed with a tremendous church. I'm blessed with tremendous colleagues who have poured into me, and I'm grateful. Most of my colleagues, Charlotte, what are you doing?
Walking.
I'm glad you're here to keep me posted.
You're welcome.
We still need 100 people to take a slot for vacation Bible school. If you're not called to go with the youth to Sevierville or called to go to Guatemala with that group and you want to be a missionary to children right here in good old Dunwoody, we can take one morning, we can take 4 mornings. Just come up to Charlotte, get a post-it, write your name, email, and a phone number and put it back on her. And you'll let her know that you want to be able to serve. The other thing I'm giving out is fans. And on these fans, it says, on the road with DUMC. I've never been here during a regular summer, but I've heard it that some of you travel during the summer. Is that true? So while you travel, I hope you'll go on the road with the Holy Spirit. I hope you'll take one of these. And every Sunday that you're not in one of these pews or because you're with us online, you can take a picture of wherever you are in the world and show us that you're on the road with Dunwoody United Methodist Church so we can spread the good news far beyond these doors. Now go. Now go, led where the love of Christ leads, to transform neighbor and neighborhood. I invite you to lift your voices and come and greet these new members as we leave today. And Charlotte.